Eu queria inicialmente fazer um agradecimento, primeiro pelo comparecimento de todos vocês e por prestigiar esse evento, evento que foi idealizado por conta da... Na verdade, foi idealizado por conta de alguns acontecimentos que aconteceram no início do ano e foi possível tudo isso ser viabilizado. Hein? Nós contamos com várias presenças de pessoas importantes aqui, acabou de ver uma, que é a diretora aqui da Justiça Federal. Muito obrigado pela presença. Esse evento foi idealizado por conta de alguns eventos que aconteceram no início do ano. E seguindo a isso, nós fizemos um convênio à Escola da Magistratura Federal, na pessoa, obviamente, da diretora principal, que é a doutora Cecília Mello. Fizemos um convênio com o apoio da doutora Consuelo. Foi possível fazer um convênio com a Universidade de Syracuse, que fica nos Estados Unidos, que é uma das... ela não é muito conhecida, mas é uma das mais prestigiosas dentro dos Estados Unidos, principalmente por americanos. Ela está muito bem ranqueada, e isso foi importante para nós aqui do Brasil fazer esse convênio. Então, eu sei que muitos juízes, talvez alguns não saibam desse convênio, então é possível lá fazer cursos de pós-graduação com base nesse convênio. A universidade garante vagas e tem alguns benefícios que quem quiser, por favor, só solicitar por e-mail. A gente fornece o acordo e o convênio, que tem a versão em português, obviamente. Então, graças a esse convênio, foi possível, e com os apoios e também da universidade lá, foi possível, sim, fazer este acontecimento, que tem também, e não posso deixar de mencionar, o apoio da JUFESP. Aqui está na mesa o presidente da associação, Fernando Mendes, que deu um grande apoio para isso e foi importante para a realização deste evento. E mais que isso, além disso, tivemos também o apoio, e nada se viabiliza sozinho, o apoio da GRU Airports, porque foi possível viabilizar via a GRU o fornecimento de equipamentos para a tradução para aqueles que precisam. E é um curso que tem que ser dado em inglês por conta do professor, que não fala português, e isso é bastante importante. Então, a idealização desse curso foi possível e vem no momento certo. Não sei se vocês sabem, mas já existem duas investigações no Brasil envolvendo financiamento ao terrorismo. Duas investigações de pessoas que vieram ao Brasil. Uma delas pediu a extradição, e foi pedida a extradição pelo governo estrangeiro, um determinado governo estrangeiro. Isso tudo é meio sigiloso, então eu vou falar sem citar nomes e países, mas foi pedida a extradição e houve a negativa do Supremo. E depois se descobriu que essa pessoa, em tese, seria uma das idealizadoras de um esquema de financiamento a terrorismo, financiamento mesmo ao ISIS, né, ao Estado Islâmico. E tem um outro caso também de investigação no Brasil, envolvendo uma outra pessoa que também remetendo e fazendo propagandas em favor do Estado Islâmico, de nacionalidade estrangeira, mas que vive aqui, e que solicitou o reconhecimento de refugiado no país, temendo algum pedido de extradição no futuro. Esse pedido de reconhecimento de refúgio não foi reconhecido ainda, mas, enfim, está sob investigação também esses casos. Vejam, com esse assunto que parece que está longe, não tem nada longe e não diz respeito só aos Estados Unidos e muito menos só aos países aliados, que estão fazendo um trabalho que vai ser muito melhor explicado pelo professor. E agora que ele está com o tradutor, eu agradeço realmente, é uma honra a escola receber um professor, primeiro da Universidade de Syracuse, que é a universidade prestigiada nos Estados Unidos, segundo pela disponibilidade dele vir e a boa vontade de vir falar isso para os brasileiros. Terceiro, que tem uma expertise, que é o Departamento de Segurança Nacional americano, e que também trabalhou em setor de inteligência, dentro desse setor, especificamente inteligência, e sabe muito sobre o tema, trabalhou internamente, sabe das dificuldades e das problemáticas e das questões sensíveis que envolvem o tema, principalmente essa questão do ISIS. Então, eu acho que nada melhor do que nós contarmos com um professor desse naipe, desse nível, para estar aqui. E eu agradeço muito a presença do professor, agradeço à Universidade de Syracuse pelo apoio que deu imediatamente assim que foi idealizado o curso. E nós só temos a ganhar com o professor aqui. Eu fiz questão de constar aqui a presença na mesa do desembargador André Nekrasov, que só engrandece aqui a mesa. Muito obrigado pela presença, obrigado a todos. E eu acho que agora a gente só podia passar a palavra ao professor, mas antes disso eu vou mencionar o currículo mais especificadamente, que está aqui. Deixa eu ver se tem alguma coisa que eu já não falei. Ele tem dado conferência sobre o tema do nosso curso, também outros temas, não fica só no tema da inteligência e a questão do terrorismo, mas ele tem falado de outros temas importantes, que envolve direito constitucional, que envolve direito criminal, lei de segurança nacional, direito administrativo. É professor da universidade, professor assistente da faculdade, foi professor assistente da Universidade de George Mason, em Arlington, Virgínia, no estado de Virgínia, isso até 2014. É diretor responsável pelo currículo de segurança nacional e de fronteiras em período de 2008 e 2014 e consultor do periódico National Security Law Journal até 2014 também. E que foi interessante que ele foi vice-secretário assistente para o desenvolvimento de políticas do Departamento de Segurança Nacional dos Estados Unidos em Washington, em 2006 e 2007. Enfim, eu acho que melhor a gente passar a palavra ao professor, que vai falar hoje, nesse primeiro módulo, falar sobre contra-terrorismo, princípios constitucionais, interrogatório e tortura. Com a palavra, o ilustre professor de Syracuse, Nathan Sales.
Bom dia. Obrigado. So you see my Portuguese is not so good. Bom dia to everyone. Obrigado. Obrigada. Thank you for coming. It's a great pleasure to be here with you in Sao Paulo. I've never been to Sao Paulo before. I spent a week in Rio a few years ago and fell in love with caipirinhas and feijoada. So it is a great pleasure for me to be back in the land of caipirinhas and feijoada. The first lecture I would like to give you concerns counterterrorism, constitutional rights, interrogation, and torture. Before we get into the material, I would like to tell you about how we teach law in the United States. In the United States, law professors and people in their classes have conversations. It's not just a lecture where somebody stands in the front of the room and speaks and speaks and speaks, and people in the audience try to stay awake.
we have a more interactive conversation type style. So I would like very much to involve you in the conversation today. So please feel free to participate, to speak, to answer questions as we work through the material. And I think we will all benefit from having a mutual and shared conversation. So let's start with the basic question. So we know that torture is illegal. Torture is illegal both under international law and under the laws of UN member states. So we see here a general legal obligation under the Convention Against Torture. All states have a legal obligation to take effective steps to prevent any acts of torture in any territory under the state's control. And then the second key provision here in international law is no exceptions. This is called non-derogability. There are never any circumstances, according to the UN Convention Against Torture, in which a state may engage in torture. So we're going to talk about what this law means in a moment, but I'd like to start us by thinking about the policy explanation here. Why is it that torture is illegal? Why not use torture as a routine instrument of national policy? Or why not use it as an occasional instrument of national policy? Why do we have a sweeping categorical ban on torture in every and all circumstances? Let me ask my colleagues in the audience if they have any thoughts on this question. Don't be shy. Or perhaps our esteemed judicial colleagues.
Torture is illegal, it's a question. Because it's not acceptance, it's a violation of human rights.
So it's a violation of human rights. It is an affront to human dignity. It's wrong, right? It's simply wrong as a matter of morality, as a matter of justice, as a matter of human rights. And we shouldn't do things that offend people's fundamental human rights and fundamental human dignity. So there's one reason. Why else do we prohibit torture across the board and categorically? It's not effective. Why is it not effective? Because people lie. And why do they lie? They lie to make the pain stop. Right? The theory is torture inflicts such unbearable and excruciating pain that the person who is the victim will say anything necessary to make it stop. Yes, you want me to say I killed President Kennedy in 1963? I did it. I was born in 1974, but I will still say that I did it just to make the pain stop, right? Why else do we prohibit torture? It's violence? And so what is the effect of the violence on the perpetrator, on the torturer? So we know that torture causes harm to the victim. Does torture harm the perpetrator, the person who is performing the torture? How does it affect us as a society or us as individuals if we live in a world where torture is permitted? Well, it sort of weakens our respect for human life, right? It weakens our respect for human rights and dignity. We become gradually more coarse and more violent as a society if we permit this practice to take place. Let's see. So we have some of these reasons here on the board. Why not torture? It's immoral. It has a negative effect on society as a whole and on the people who perform torture. Pretext, what do I mean by that? So we might say the reason we want to torture somebody is because they have important information and we need to get the information from them. But it turns out that's not really the reason you're inflicting the torture. Maybe you're doing it because you want to suppress political dissidents. You're just using the interrogation as a cover story. You don't actually want information. You want to inflict pain in order to punish your opponents or punish unpopular groups, right? So that's so the concern about what we might call pretext is another reason why we have a complete legal ban on torture. We might try to put legal limits on torture. So you can use certain techniques, but not others. We might allow you to use, for instance, waterboarding, but we might not allow electric shocks, right? Well, one of the concerns is that whatever limits you put in place to try and prevent torture from getting out of hand or extreme won't be effective, because the people who are performing the torture might go beyond the limits that have been put in place. And in fact, there are concerns that precisely this happened with the CIA's interrogation program of Al-Qaeda detainees. We'll talk about that a little bit later on. And then reliability, as the gentleman here said. We don't torture because the information we get might not be very reliable, right? The information might be false because the victim simply wants the pain to stop and will say whatever is necessary for it to do so. So now the question becomes, are there any exceptions? Are there any situations in which, despite our moral and other reservations about torture, are there nevertheless circumstances in which it should be permitted? And so the classic example that is often given is the ticking time bomb. So here we have Jack Bauer from the American television show 24. Jack Bauer knows that a terrorist has a nuclear weapon and is going to detonate it in downtown New York City within the next hour, because the show is over in an hour. So we know it's going to happen in the next hour. So is Jack Bauer or any other hypothetical interrogator justified in using torture in order to extract information that could be useful in preventing a nuclear holocaust of 8 million people, right? So notice the assumptions that are embedded in this hypothetical situation, the ticking time bomb situation. First of all, we're assuming that the attack is imminent. The attack is going to happen immediately. It's going to happen today, as opposed to at some point in the distant future, a couple of weeks, a couple of months from now. So this scenario also assumes that the detainee knows about the plot and that the information will be useful in disrupting the plot. And the third thing we're assuming is that the only way to get the information is through torture. You can't get it, for instance, by intercepting somebody's email or intercepting phone calls, or you can't get it through less coercive, less violent means of interrogation. So any one of these three assumptions might be false or inaccurate in a given case. It might be true that the attack is going to happen 3 months from now. We have time to develop intelligence from other sources. Right? Or it might be the case that torture isn't the only way we can get the information, right? Maybe if we establish a relationship, a non-confrontational relationship with the detainee, the person will acknowledge his role in the plot and provide information about it. Or we might be able to use electronic surveillance to collect the necessary information to disrupt the plot. So remember also what the UN Convention Against Torture says. The ban on torture is non-derogable. There are never any circumstances, there are never any exceptions in which torture should be legally permitted, right? So what do we mean by torture? We know that it's illegal, both internationally and under domestic law, and we know some of the reasons why torture is not allowed. The question then becomes, what kind of conduct constitutes torture? What kind of conduct meets the legal definition? So here we have the definition contained in the UN Convention Against Torture. And it says that the term torture means any act by which severe pain or suffering, whether physical or mental, is intentionally inflicted on a person. When such pain or suffering is inflicted by or at the instigation of, or with the consent or acquiescence of, a public official or other person acting in an official capacity. So that's international law, the definition of torture, which brings us to U.S. law. What does torture mean in U.S. law? As we'll see, the United States law is narrower in several important respects than the Convention Against Torture. So, in U.S. law, torture means an act committed by a person acting under color of law, specifically intended to inflict severe physical or mental pain or suffering upon another person within his custody or control. Notice also the ban on torture in the U.S. only applies to conduct that takes place outside the U.S., right? So this portion of the statute here says whoever outside the United States commits or attempts to commit torture shall be fined or sentenced to imprisonment. Right? So let's walk through the torture statute in U.S. law and the Convention Against Torture at international law to see how they're similar and to see how they differ. So here we have a comparison of the two different laws. So one difference concerns geography. Under the Convention Against Torture, the prohibition on torture applies everywhere in the world, right? Both to conduct that takes place abroad and to conduct that takes place at home. Under U.S. law, the way Congress has written the legislation, the ban on torture only applies to conduct outside the U.S. borders. Who may not be tortured? Well, somebody who is in your custody, right? So that requirement appears both in the Convention Against Torture and in U.S. legislation. In both cases, good thing I just checked. I got that wrong. In the U.S., the victim must be in the defendant's custody. By contrast, under international law, there is no custody requirement. You cannot torture anybody, even if they're not in your custody. What kind of harm, what kind of injury counts as torture? Well, under international law, the standard is severe pain or suffering, whether physical or mental. We see something similar in U.S. law, severe physical or mental pain or suffering. But as we'll see, this definition in the legislation has been given a very narrow interpretation, both by Congress and by the executive branch when interpreting the statute. Finally, we have the question of mens rea, or mental state. What sort of intent must the defendant have in order to be in order to violate the statute, in order to violate the law? Under international law, the standard is intent. The defendant must intend to produce severe physical or mental pain or suffering. U.S. law is narrower here in another respect, right? So in U.S. law, you must specifically intend, not just intend to commit or cause harm, but specifically intend to cause harm. As we'll see later on in this conversation, that is a very important feature of U.S. law, and it narrows the scope of the prohibition in U.S. law on terrorism. So what counts as severe physical pain or suffering? So here we have a memorandum prepared by the Justice Department, the U.S. Justice Department, in 2002. This is, to put it mildly, an extremely controversial memorandum. It adopts an extremely narrow definition of severe physical pain and suffering. When this memorandum was leaked to the New York Times in 2004, it caused a great deal of controversy, so much so that the Justice Department immediately revoked the memo, rescinded the memorandum as soon as it became public. So the standard here is severe pain must rise to the level that would ordinarily be associated with a sufficiently serious physical condition or injury, such as death, organ failure, or serious impairment of body functions in order to constitute torture. Where did they come up with that very narrow definition? Well, what the Justice Department lawyers did was they looked at this phrase, severe pain, and they said, all right, are there other statutes in the U.S. where Congress has used the phrase severe pain. And the theory was, well, if Congress has used the phrase severe pain in some other legislation, then whatever meaning it had there, it must also have here in the context of the torture statute. So it turns out that Congress had, in fact, used this term in another piece of legislation. Now, this was a law that regulated health benefits. It provided what sorts of benefits were available to patients in certain circumstances. So you might think that a law that deals with health benefits tries to do very different things than a law that regulates torture. And the health benefit statute isn't really all that relevant to what Congress was trying to accomplish in the torture statute. Nevertheless, the Justice Department looked at this other statute and incorporated the meaning of severe pain as understood there, here within the context of the torture statute. So a couple of examples will help illustrate how extremely narrow this definition was, right? Something, pain akin to death or organ failure or serious impairment of body functions. So suppose that an interrogator has a whip and beats a detainee with the whip. Now, we might, in our common usage, in normal conversation, we might say, yeah, of course that's torture. If you're using a whip to beat somebody, that certainly would count as torture. Applying this definition, though, you see that it might not meet the legal standard. Being hit with a whip is painful, but is the pain of a magnitude that is comparable to death or a heart attack? Probably not. Right. Suppose somebody rips off your fingernails. Again, in normal conversation, we would describe loss of a fingernail as torture. Right? My 4-year-old daughter just slammed her finger in the door and her fingernail fell off and she was agonized by it. I don't think I tortured her, but you know, that's a conversation for another day. But applying this definition, it's not at all clear that having your fingernail pulled off would count as prohibited torture. Yes, it's painful, but is it akin to death? Is it equivalent to organ failure? This helps explain why this memorandum was so extremely controversial, because basically nothing counts as torture under this standard, or essentially nothing that the United States or a civilized nation would ever consider doing would meet the definition. It basically gives the green light to any sort of interrogation technique. What about specific intent? This is another aspect of U.S. law that is narrower than international law. So according to the Justice Department memo from 2002, this limits the type of conduct that is prohibited by the legislation. In order for a defendant to have acted with specific intent, he must expressly intend to achieve the forbidden act. Here, because the torture statute requires that a defendant act with specific intent to inflict severe pain, the infliction of such pain must be the defendant's precise objective. Right? In other words, it only counts as torture if you are specifically intending to cause pain. If you know that pain will result, right, that's not enough. It's not enough to have knowledge that severe pain will occur. The pain must be your objective. The pain must be your specific point. Right? You're torturing not because you want to get information, but because you want to inflict pain. Again, that drastically narrows the type of conduct that is reached by the statute, as we'll see later on. So let's apply this law, U.S. law and international law, to some of the specific interrogation techniques that the CIA was using. By way of background, in 2004, as I mentioned, the Justice Department repealed that memorandum and adopted a more expansive, a more sweeping understanding of what kind of conduct is prohibited torture. So what exactly was the CIA doing under these memoranda? Some of the techniques are fairly mild, fairly weak. Some of them are much more brutal, much more aggressive. So these techniques were then reapproved by the Justice Department in 2005. One of the techniques that's fairly mild is dietary manipulation. What that means is they give you an Ensure shake. I don't know if you have these in Sao Paulo. It's basically a milkshake with lots of protein in it. Instead of eating a full meal, you know, you drink a shake. And that was one of the techniques that the CIA used on the so-called high-value detainees. Another one is the attention grasp. I'm not going to depict it to you, but I'll do it to myself. You grab somebody by the shirt. You get very close to their face and shake them. Not violently shake them, but shake them enough to let them know that you are physically trying to intimidate them. Again, not a terribly aggressive technique. Another one was so-called walling. You would put a collar around somebody's neck and then push them up against the wall. The wall was hollow. And so because the wall was hollow, the noise was much louder. So why was there a collar? Why was the wall hollow? Because now we're starting to see some techniques that look more like torture, that look more aggressive. Well, it turns out the collar was put on in order to prevent whiplash, to protect the neck, to protect the head from pain, to protect the head and neck from being hyperextended as the shoulders and the back are pushed up against the wall. Why is the wall hollow? Well, it's not just to produce a loud sound and thereby scare the detainee. The wall is also hollow to cushion the blow, right? Hitting a hollow wall is less painful than hitting bricks or concrete, or so the theory goes. What about sleep deprivation? This technique was considerably more brutal than some of the other ones that the CIA was using. So let's apply the statutory standard, the standard from the legislation: severe physical or mental pain or suffering. So does sleep deprivation cause physical pain or suffering? Well, to answer that question, we need to know a little bit about exactly how the sleep deprivation took place. So the detainees were kept awake for up to 180 hours. That's 7.5 days, so a considerable length of time. What effect did this prolonged sleep deprivation have on the detainees? Well, being awake for 7.5 days causes hallucinations. It causes feelings of unease, disorientation, nausea, and various other negative consequences. So does that count as severe physical pain or suffering? Well, the Justice Department in 2005 said, no, it doesn't. And the reason they said it doesn't is because after looking at medical literature, it turns out that people recover very quickly from sleep deprivation. There were a number of psychological studies of university student volunteers who were kept awake for prolonged periods of time, 7, 8, 9, 10 days. And the Justice Department said, the literature indicates, the scientific literature indicates that if you are allowed to sleep for 12 hours, you sort of go back to normal almost immediately. And so the Justice Department says, because you recover so quickly from the disorientation and hallucinations associated with sleeplessness, it doesn't count as torture. So one of the things we might say in response to this is that the medical literature that the Justice Department relied upon isn't really relevant here, because the conditions in the experiment were different from the conditions in the interrogation room. So in the interrogation room, the CIA detainees are kept awake by being shackled to the wall, right? And so the idea is if you nod off and fall asleep, the chain that's holding you to the wall will sort of pull your arm and wake you back up. So that's a very different type of sleep deprivation than having a university student volunteer kept awake in a comfortable room, right? You might experience severe physical pain because you fall asleep and the chain dislocates your shoulder, right? I don't know if you remember the movie, one of the lethal weapon movies where Mel Gibson dislocates his shoulder underwater and it's excruciatingly painful, right? I still can't watch it without having to look away. That kind of pain might happen if you've been kept awake for 6 days, chained to a wall, you fall asleep, and the weight of your body dislocates your shoulder as your arm is attached to the wall. What about mental pain or suffering? Does prolonged sleep deprivation cause severe mental pain or suffering? So to answer that question, we need to know a little bit more about what the legislation says about the definition of mental pain or suffering. So we have a very long and complicated definition here. I will summarize it for you as follows. Severe mental pain or suffering means prolonged mental harm, right? So not just temporary mental harm, but prolonged mental harm that in turn is caused by several different acts. Intentional infliction or threatened infliction of severe physical pain or suffering, administration of mind-altering substances, hallucinogenic drugs, something like that. Third, if you threaten somebody with death, or fourth, if you do any of these things to a third party, right? If you torture somebody's child, right? And then the person suffers prolonged mental harm, that would be considered severe mental pain or suffering and therefore torture. So back to the Justice Department memorandum. DOJ says there's no prolonged mental harm here. And again, the reason is because looking at the scientific literature, it turns out that when people are allowed to sleep after being deprived of sleep for a long period of time, they go back to normal almost immediately. So again, the question becomes, is that medical literature relevant? Consider how the interrogation relationship is different from the relationship between a university psychologist and a subject of the experiment. The subject of the experiment doesn't have an adversarial, contentious relationship with a professor. I mean, some students don't like their professors, but it's not a hostile relationship to the point of torture, right? Also, they're volunteers. They're getting paid, you know, $5 an hour for beer money or whatever. They see this experiment as beneficial to them. Otherwise, they wouldn't have volunteered to be there. And the conditions of the experiment room are very pleasant, right? It's not a cold stone room with people chained to walls. Right? So again, it's not clear that the medical literature that DOJ is relying upon is actually measuring the same sorts of treatment that the CIA was undertaking in its interrogations. What about waterboarding? Yes, question right here, please.
Just before we move on, I have a quick question regarding the previous slide.
Yes.
On dietary manipulation. I was just wondering if back in 2005 we already had the force feeding techniques.
So the force feeding techniques were not so. The interrogators didn't really understand those to be methods of interrogation, but rather methods of defeating a hunger strike. Right. So the thinking was, if a detainee is undergoing a hunger strike to protest their treatment, to protest the fact that they are being detained, we have to provide them with water, we have to provide them with food in order to keep them alive. And sometimes the techniques used to perform this feeding were unpleasant, right? Rectal feeding, rectal hydration, not something that anybody would want to undergo. From the CIA standpoint, the interrogators didn't see that as part of the interrogation program. It wasn't, let's rectally feed somebody and get them to talk, right? It was, let's rectally feed somebody, keep them alive so that we can continue to ask them questions. I actually don't know about the timing, but it wouldn't surprise me if that was going on now. That, at least from the CIA standpoint, was not considered dietary manipulation, but problematic for some of the reasons that we can all think of. Yes, please.
I have one question. You said that the DOJ accept the is for them according to the medical literature. It's there is no problem of sleep deprivation. What about the court? They have already decided over this question?
So how have the courts interpreted these statutes and this legislation? Actually, there isn't very much judicial precedent here. That's why you have, let me go back to the, that's why you have a memo, there we go, from the Justice Department. The Justice Department lawyers have to interpret the statute themselves because we don't have very much case law from the judiciary explaining what these terms mean. So what about waterboarding? Even if you don't think that sleep deprivation is torture, what about waterboarding? Well, first of all, what is waterboarding? It's a form of simulated drowning in which a detainee is put on an incline, the face is covered with a towel, and then water is poured into the nose. And because of the position of the head, the water fills your nasal cavity, but doesn't actually go down your throat. So it feels like you're drowning, but you don't actually ingest water. You don't aspirate the water, or so the theory goes. Those who have experienced waterboarding describe it as excruciating. The sensation of drowning induces panic and anguish of a sort that is very difficult to imagine. How often was waterboarding used? Apparently, it was used only on 3 detainees, at least according to the CIA, although that number has now been called into some question. We know for certain that there were 3 people who were subjected to the waterboard. The first is Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. He was the mastermind of the 9/11 plot. He was captured by Pakistani intelligence and then handed over to the CIA and kept. He was kept by the CIA at a bunch of black sites overseas before eventually being brought to Guantanamo Bay. The next person is Abu Zubaydah. Abu Zubaydah was the number 3 figure in Al-Qaeda, believed to be the number 3 figure in Al-Qaeda in charge of planning operations. And the third person was Abd al-Rahim al-Nashahiri. He was the operational ringleader for Al-Qaeda in the Gulf. He was responsible for planning Al-Qaeda attacks in the Persian Gulf region. He was also the mastermind of the 2000 attack on the USS Cole. You might remember the US ship that was bombed in the harbor. So let's apply. Do we have a question? I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. Could you speak up? USS Cole? Yeah, that was Nashahiri. Yeah. Okay, got it. Great. Thanks. So is waterboarding torture? Well, let's apply the elements of the statute, the terms of the legislation. So what does it feel like to be waterboarded? Well, as I said, it is a form of simulated drowning. You're unable to breathe. This induces panic and anxiety of a very intense and severe sort. DOJ, the Justice Department lawyers in 2005, say it's not torture. Why not? Well, they say, well, the pain and suffering only lasts for the 40 seconds during which the water is applied. So the water is applied, the detainee is given a break, they are allowed to breathe 3 times, 4 times, the water is reapplied for 40 seconds, there's a break, and so on. So the Justice Department says the duration of the suffering, the duration of the pain, it's very, very short. So it doesn't count as severe pain. It doesn't count as severe suffering unless it's of long duration, right? So, you know, we might question that. We might question whether the duration, the length of the pain, is actually necessary for it to be considered severe. So, for instance, imagine that an interrogator had used an electric wire attached to a battery, and it, you know, shocked a detainee's private parts with electrical current, right? That would be excruciatingly painful. And even if it only lasts for 2 or 3 or 4 seconds, in our normal usage and our normal understanding, we would say, of course, that's torture. Anytime you're using electric shocks on somebody's genitals, that has to be torture. DOJ says no. Well, they're not actually addressing the electric shock example. But as to waterboarding, the Justice Department says, well, no, that doesn't count because the length of the pain is simply too short. What about mental pain or suffering? Does waterboarding cause severe mental pain or suffering? Maybe, depending on whom you ask. We'll come to that in a second. So you may remember the British journalist Christopher Hitchens. Christopher Hitchens, several years ago, volunteered to try out waterboarding to see what it was like. So they put him on the board, they pour water over him, and they gave him metal weights to hold in his hands. And they said, as soon as you can't take it anymore, drop the metal weights and we'll stop. He lasted 16 seconds, and after the fact, wrote about the experience and said, if this isn't torture, nothing is. He was still haunted by the experience months and months later. So does that cause mental pain or suffering? Well, the Justice Department says no. Christopher Hitchens and other observers say yes. So why not? Why doesn't waterboarding cause mental pain or prolonged mental pain or suffering, according to the government? Well, part of it is because of so-called SEER training. This is training that armed forces members undertake as part of their training program. It stands for Survive, Evade, Resist, and Extract. Our soldiers, not just American soldiers, but soldiers in other countries as well, are taught what to do if they're ever behind enemy lines. If your plane gets shot down and you parachute out behind enemy lines, here's what you need to do to survive. Here's how to make contact with locals. Here's how to request extraction by U.S. forces. Here's how to live off the food you can find by foraging, and so on. One of the other things that you're taught as part of SEER training is how to resist interrogation. If you're captured by the Russians, they might ask you some very blunt questions, and they might use waterboarding. So as a matter of practice, US soldiers all undergo waterboarding as part of their SEER training. And here we have a picture of US soldiers experiencing the practice. So the Justice Department says, look, we have a lot of experience with how people respond to waterboarding. We know what U.S. soldiers react to, how U.S. soldiers react to it as part of their training program. And the Justice Department says, well, look, U.S. soldiers who have been waterboarded don't experience any lasting, lingering effects from the practice. As soon as it's over, they sort of go back to normal. So that tells us something about how Al-Qaeda detainees are likely to react to waterboarding, and they probably won't have any prolonged harm from it either. Once again, we have to ask whether this is a legitimate analogy. Is waterboarding as it's performed by the CIA different from waterboarding as it's performed by the U.S. military as part of its training operations? And there actually appear to be a number of potentially significant differences. One of the most important is the relationship between a soldier and the person pouring the water is very different than the relationship between Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and the CIA interrogator. You know, that relationship is antagonistic and adversarial. The relationship between the soldier and his commanding officer is not. The commanding officer wants the soldier to resist, right? They want the soldier to survive the experience, whereas the CIA interrogator wants the person to break, right? There's an adversarial relationship there, and you want the detainee to give up, right? Also, it only happens once to the soldier. Right? You have the water poured on you for one application, and then you're done. And you know while it's being performed on you during your training that it's going to be over soon. If you're Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and you're experiencing 83 rounds of waterboarding, you know there's no end in sight. You don't have the comfort, the hope that this experience is going to be a short experience. So again, the differences between the types of waterboarding might result in a different outcome, right? Maybe waterboarding performed by the CIA causes more pain, causes more suffering than waterboarding as part of, you know, routine U.S. military training. Let's go back to specific intent. Remember, U.S. law provides that in order for conduct to count as torture, the person must have the specific intent to inflict severe physical or mental pain or suffering. Simple knowledge that the interrogation will cause that kind of pain or suffering isn't enough. You must specifically intend, right? So why is that so important to determining the scope of the statute? Why is that so important to determining what kind of conduct is illegal? Well, it matters a lot because imagine an interrogator, a defendant in a criminal case, who had a good faith belief that the interrogation techniques he was using would not, in fact, cause severe physical or mental pain or suffering. You know, what happens if that person genuinely believes, because Justice Department lawyers have told him, that the pain and the suffering that he is inflicting on a detainee doesn't rise to the level of torture? So he has the intent, this interrogator has the necessary intent under the statute to perform the act, to pour the water, to shackle the detainee to the wall. But does that person have the necessary specific intent under the statute to cause physical pain or suffering? Maybe not, right? Maybe not, because you have in your back pocket a memorandum from the Justice Department saying, hey guys, trust us. We've looked at the medical literature. We've looked at the legal standards. We've looked at the techniques you're using, and we've concluded that the pain and suffering isn't enough to meet the legal standard, right? If you have that kind of memorandum in your back pocket, it might defeat the mental state necessary to establish liability under the statute. The memo might function as a get-out-of-jail-free card, to borrow from the US board game known as Monopoly. Now, what about the other part of the Convention Against Torture? So international law does not just require member states to prohibit torture. It also requires member states to prohibit a lesser form of mistreatment that's known as cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment. So each state party shall undertake to prevent in any territory under its jurisdiction other acts of cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment or punishment which do not amount to torture. So what does that mean? So even if a given technique like waterboarding, like sleep deprivation, doesn't meet the legal definition of torture, it still might well meet the legal definition of cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment. So let's look at how that term has been interpreted in U.S. law. So when the United States ratified the Convention Against Torture back in the early 1990s, the U.S. Senate included what's known as a reservation. It announced its interpretation of the phrase cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment. And Congress said, we understand that term to mean cruel, unusual, and inhumane treatment or punishment that is prohibited by the 5th, 8th, or 14th Amendments to the U.S. Constitution, right? So one question is, what legal effect does this reservation have? When Congress announced this interpretation in 1994, what was the legal effect of that? What is the United States obliged to do, and what is the United States not required to do? Well, it turns out that this reservation basically duplicates the already required law of the Constitution. If you're already prohibited from doing something, if the Fifth Amendment already prohibits you from doing something, then the Convention Against Torture doesn't really add anything to that prohibition. In other words, this reservation has the effect of making the U.S. obligation under domestic law exactly the same as its obligation under international law. International law doesn't really add anything to what is already required by the U.S. Constitution. Where things stand today. Well, let's go back to a couple of those techniques that the CIA was using. So the legal standard in the U.S. is it's cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment if it would violate the Constitution. So is it a violation of the Constitution for police to shackle somebody to the wall and keep them awake for 7.5 days? And to ask the question like that, it almost answers itself. Of course it is. Of course, if police officers were chaining criminals to walls and keeping them awake for 7.5 days, I mean, the American Civil Liberties Union, the ACLU, would file a lawsuit within 2 minutes right? Of course that kind of conduct violates the Constitution. It also violates the Convention Against Torture as a result. If it's unconstitutional, it's a violation of international law. What about waterboarding? Would it violate the Constitution for police officers to use waterboarding when questioning criminal suspects? Of course it would. Of course that would violate the Fifth Amendment, the Eighth Amendment, and various other constitutional guarantees. If it violates the Constitution, it also would violate international law under the U.S. understanding. So, back to waterboarding, back to sleep deprivation. Even if it's not torture, it's very plausibly a violation of the Constitution, and therefore a violation of another part of the Convention Against Torture, the ban on cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment. See how we're doing on time. Yeah, okay, good. So let me bring you up to date with where things stand today. So the Bush administration actually took a number of steps to rein in the CIA in the early 2000s. Waterboarding stopped as early as 2003. After those three detainees were waterboarded, they basically stopped using it 12 years ago. The entire program, the enhanced interrogation program for the so-called high-value detainees, winds down in late 2007. And all of the detainees were transferred out of CIA custody by 2008. Basically, they were taken from the CIA black sites and put to put in Guantanamo Bay under the jurisdiction of the U.S. Army. The Obama administration implemented several other reforms to prevent these sorts of interrogation techniques. On his second day in office, President Obama issues an executive order providing that an individual in the custody of the U.S. Shall not be subjected to any interrogation technique that is not authorized by and listed in the Army Field Manual. So what is the Army Field Manual? This is a comprehensive document that governs U.S. Army operations. Part of the manual concerns interrogation. It lists certain techniques that may be used and certain techniques that may not be used when interrogating people you've captured during time of war. Right. So what kinds of techniques are prohibited by the Army Field Manual? It turns out that it's extremely restrictive. It turns out that the Army is prohibited from using interrogation methods that police officers use every single day in the United States, and I suspect in Brazil and other countries as well. So for instance, are you allowed to threaten a detainee? Can you say something like, if you don't tell us when the bomb is going to go off, you're going to regret it? It turns out you can't. The Army Field Manual says you must never threaten, you must never coerce a source. This sort of thing is fairly routine in the United States. Prosecutors will say something like the following: we know that you just murdered your wife, right? If you don't cooperate with us, we're going to seek the death penalty. Right. We're going to seek the maximum penalty allowed under the law. If you cooperate, you know, we'll make sure it's only 25 years in prison. If you don't cooperate, we're going to throw the book at you, and you're going to go away forever, basically. Police officers use this technique in the United States, but the Army Field Manual prohibits the Army from using it. And now the CIA is also prohibited from using this technique. What about the good cop, bad cop routine? The Army Field Manual describes this as Mutt and Jeff. I don't know why they call it that. But the technique, you know, if you've watched a cop show on television, you know it. There's two interrogators in the room. One is really friendly and nice and sympathetic to the detainee. The other one is cruel and mean and aggressive. And so they play off of each other. This is a routine occurrence in American police work, and I imagine in Brazil and other countries too. It turns out that this technique is very strictly regulated by the Army Field Manual. It's very, very difficult if you are an Army interrogator, and now a CIA interrogator, to use this method. For the Army, you have to get approval from a senior officer, an 06 level officer. I had to look that one up. I didn't know it either. What that means is if you're in the Army, you need a full colonel. Right? So somebody just short of a general has to approve it. If you're in the Navy, you have to get approval from a captain. So like Captain Kirk has to say yes before you can use an interrogation technique that police use every single day in the United States. Solitary confinement. Can you?
Excuse me.
Yes, Fausto, please.
I didn't understand very well what is good cop and bad cop.
Okay, so
you're going to explain?
Yeah, let me be more clear about that. So good cop, bad cop. So somebody comes in the room and yells at the detainee, "You're worthless. We know you did it. If you don't confess, we're gonna be strict and give you the death penalty." And then another person comes in, and the good cop comes in and kicks the other guy out and says, "Look, here's a cigarette. That other guy doesn't know what he's talking about. He's stupid. Let's work together. Let's work something out." And then the bad cop comes back in and throws the good cop out. So the idea is to cause disorientation and to build a rapport between the good cop and the detainee. And the detainee will, the theory goes, bond with or respond to the good cop and confess. With the threat of the bad cop sort of looming in the background.
These are not prohibited.
It's not prohibited.
Both of them.
It's allowed for, so cops, but police officers do it all the time in the U.S. The Army can do it, but it's very difficult to get it approved. You have to ask permission from a very senior officer in the Army if you're going to use this technique in an Army interrogation. Solitary confinement. If somebody doesn't cooperate and doesn't answer your questions, can you put them in a cell by themselves? In the U.S., in U.S. criminal investigations, yes, you can. In fact, it's fairly common for people who are being investigated for crimes and taken into police custody for them to be kept in isolation. What about under the Army Field Manual? Once again, it's very difficult to use it. You can use this technique, but only very sparingly. You have to use it in very narrow circumstances, and you have to get approval from senior officers. So where do things stand now? Well, we now have in place a number of legal restrictions on intelligence interrogations that are very, very strict. Stricter than the rules that apply to ordinary criminal investigations in the United States. Basically, police officers it's easier for police officers to do interrogations now than it is for the CIA. The CIA cannot use interrogation methods and techniques that are used every single day in the United States to investigate drug trafficking, money laundering, homicide, and various other crimes that are of lesser importance, lower harm than terrorism-related offenses. So the pendulum had swung very far in one direction in the early 2000s, permitting waterboarding, permitting sleep deprivation, and other very aggressive techniques. The pendulum may have swung all the way to the other side now with even relatively modest interrogation techniques, tightly and strictly regulated. So let me pause here. I believe, Judge DeSantis, we now have time for questions and discussion. Is that right? Great.
Se alguém tiver perguntas, por favor, tá aberto.
Does anyone have any question?
So we start out with a ban by the UN, a total ban on torture, which the US interprets narrowly and gets away with it. But then we have also a ban on cruel and inhumane treatment, to which the US does not make any changes because it's already on the Constitution, if I got it right.
Yeah, that's basically, so yes.
Yes, in very simple terms, of course.
Yeah.
My question is, has the UN spoken about this this issue, specifically about cruel and inhumane treatment?
Yes and no. So there was an investigation in the United States performed by the Senate Intelligence Committee several years ago, and they produced a report that described more about what techniques were used and some of the abuses that were alleged to be associated with the program. After that report was released, the UN Secretary General, I think it was the Secretary General, or maybe it was some other UN official, issued a statement saying, we are glad that the United States is investigating this and taking its legal obligations seriously. So the U.S. report actually came out around the same time as the Brazilian torture report that the president released. Was it 2012, 13? And the UN official commented both on the Brazilian report and on the U.S. report, saying, you know, both countries are taking steps to understand their past and comply with their legal obligations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tem alguém traduzindo para ele, né?
Sim, é.
Aqui, ó. Eu fiquei com uma dúvida no início a respeito do entendimento do que era tortura dentro e fora do território dos Estados Unidos. Eu compreendi que haveria uma diferença entre as leis internacionais e a lei dos Estados Unidos sobre a definição de tortura. Havia uma informação outside. Yes.
Yes.
Correct.
Geographically, conduct must take place outside USA. Significa que
what does this mean? For example, in a military base in the US, certain actions might not be characterized as torture. Is that correct?
Right. So, practically speaking, anybody that the United States detains during a time of war is going to be kept outside the United States. So Guantanamo Bay or a CIA facility in Romania, those are outside the United States, and so the geography would make that illegal. So why would Congress exclude domestic conduct? Right? Why limit the prohibition to conduct that takes place overseas? This is just a guess. I actually don't know the answer to this question. This is just a guess. My thought was Congress is worried about lawsuits by prisoners. Right? Congress is worried about a prisoner in Leavenworth, Kansas, filing a lawsuit saying, they took away my TV. That's torture. So they would lose that case. Because loss of your television is not cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment, or severe physical or mental pain or suffering. But you still have to litigate that case, and that takes time. If there's a geographic bar, if there's a jurisdictional bar, then the case goes away immediately. So that's just a guess as to why the statute was written to apply only overseas and not inside the U.S. But I don't know for sure.
A minha dúvida.
My doubt is about when you talk about the memorandum of the Justice Department, the question was how the judiciary interprets these violations. And the answer was that nothing. Why? Isn't this taken to court?
Well, so the reason it's not taken to court is... because of the get-out-of-jail-free card. So after the Obama administration came into power in 2009, the Justice Department did a study. There was a report. Should we bring legal charges? Should we prosecute the people who were responsible? So for the torture memos and for the CIA interrogations. And so the Justice Department thought, should we prosecute the CIA people who ran the program? Should we prosecute the Justice Department lawyers who wrote the memos back in 2002 and 2005? And the result, the Obama administration said, no, we're not going to. We can't prove that they actually broke the law. And the reason we can't prove it is because, the specific intent element of the offense. We might be able to show that the interrogator has caused severe physical or mental pain or suffering, right? That they meet, that the conduct meets the definition of torture. But the Justice Department didn't think they could show that individual interrogators had the necessary mental state, right? That they were specifically intending to cause that pain. And the reason, one of the reasons why they didn't think that the prosecutions would succeed was because of these memoranda from 2002 and 2005. It would be really, really difficult, right, to prove liability because of what the memoranda had told the interrogators. And another thing was, so that's one concern that the Justice Department had. Another reason why they didn't bring charges was because they were worried about what's called risk aversion. Right? So prosecutors at the Justice Department were concerned, you know, if we prosecute the CIA now, what signal is that going to send in the future? So what happens if in the future we need the CIA or any other intelligence agency to sort of lean forward and be more aggressive? You know, maybe we don't want them to torture. We don't want them to torture, but maybe in the future we want them to sort of take some risks. Well, they're not going to do that if they know that they will be subject to criminal liability and second guessing after the fact. So it was a concern about sending the wrong signal to the CIA as well. So a couple of things were going on there.
Yeah. Back to the inside-outside geographical limits of law in terms of America. We had an example about some years ago on the Tsarnaev brothers case over the Boston Marathon. Mm-hmm. Right, and one of them was killed in a traffic mess that resulted in his death, and the other one was detained, and a lot of interrogation followed that, and then it resulted in some kind of investigation on other people and other immigrants coming from Eastern Europe and so on. And that's a case of terror inside America. Okay, that would, the question over using torture inside America would matter or not. Okay, and so even I'm not sure if his mother or his aunt or something was claiming on CNN and Al Jazeera and so on that her relative was subject to torture and so on. Then would that case be considered for some kind of lawfully intended use of torture?
Right, so I don't know the specific details of how Tsarnaev was interrogated. I know that he was interrogated by the FBI, right? So criminal investigators rather than CIA. Okay? So the CIA, by law, has no law enforcement responsibilities, and U.S. law prohibits the CIA from operating inside the United States. So it could only be the FBI. But I don't know what specific techniques or what specific questions the FBI used. But let's say that Tsarnaev's mother is right. Let's say that the FBI did actually torture him. I don't know what they did, but it wasn't the waterboard, right? Does he have any recourse if that happened? I think the answer is yes. So even though the torture statute wouldn't apply to conduct inside the United States, there are other statutes that do, and other constitutional provisions that do apply. So, for instance, the Eighth Amendment to the U.S. Constitution prohibits cruel and unusual punishment. Right, very similar language to cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. If somebody is tortured in the U.S., if Tsarnaev or anybody else is tortured in the U.S., you can imagine them filing a lawsuit against the government saying, I was subjected to cruel and unusual punishment in violation of the Eighth Amendment. Or, you know, there's the Fifth Amendment as well, which prohibits the government from depriving somebody of life or liberty or property without due process of law. And so if somebody is tortured in the United States, you can imagine them filing a suit saying, torture deprives me of liberty right? My liberty interest in human dignity and my human rights without due process, because a court never signed off on this. It was just the FBI that decided to do this on their own. So the torture statute does not apply inside the United States, but there are other laws that do apply that have the same or similar effect as prohibiting torture. Thank you. Yes.
My question refers to the question of the few precedents of American courts. Is there a possibility of an American court to judge torture committed by a member of the American Army, or there is a military jurisdiction for that matter? Up to where goes a civil, American civil jurisdiction as to the control of acts by the American Army?
Good question. So the Army is governed by a separate system of laws. It's called the Uniform Code of Military Justice. And there are laws there that are similar to the laws that apply to civilians, such as the torture statute. So if a member of the Army were charged under the Uniform Code of Military Justice and prosecuted by a court-martial for something like torture, you know, there are provisions of the UCMJ, the Uniform Code of Military Justice, that apply there. And the judge in the court-martial might say, well, let's interpret whatever this statute means in light of the torture statute that applies elsewhere. And we can imagine the opposite thing happening as well. There were a prosecution under the torture statute of a civilian government employee, we can imagine a judge there saying, we don't have a whole lot of case law interpreting this statute for ourselves, but let's look at what the military courts have done with similar statutes that apply to the Army.
Bom dia.
Bom dia.
No caso aqui, o Brasil, nós temos o livro branco, que é livro feito pela, praticamente agora em 2012, mais ou menos, pela norma de padronização do Exército Brasileiro, Marinha, Aeronáutica e as Forças Armadas, Estado-Maior, que agora é praticamente uma pessoa ligada à própria Presidência da República. Com os sucessivos fatos agora ocorridos, depois do pós-guerra e algumas coisas atuais, a Presidente da República resolveu devolver o próprio Exército, a Marinha Aeronáutica, a responsabilidade por esses atos. Ela mesmo delegou esses poderes a ele. Agora, no caso da tortura em si, ela existe, é normal, é territorial. Então, a tortura comum, que é o dia a dia, a coisa comum. Mas na guerra, eu sou franco a dizer a Vossa Excelência também, eu sou a favor do Obama, porque eu acho que na guerra, no amor, vale tudo. O senhor tem que usar as normas procedimentais, inclusive, do jeito que está o Afeganistão, o Iraque e também agora esse Estado Islâmico, Israel principalmente, né, é uma coisa muito velha, antiga. Quer dizer, isso já vem da Primeira, Segunda e tantas guerras que estão sucessivamente. Eu acho que tem que coibir. Acho que até não é nem a tortura, mas é eliminar algumas coisas que devem ser padronizadas realmente. É eliminar alguns que não tem mais conserto mesmo. Não precisa nem torturar mais. Forcar não vai adiantar. Arrancar o dedo não vai arrancar. O cara volta e faz, quer dizer, ele vai ficar em Guantánamo, Cuba, e vai para lá e vem para cá, quer dizer, for aqui no Brasil, eu vou ser bem franco com o senhor, se eu fosse, eu enforcava. Eu sou a favor mesmo do George Bush. Sou adepto dele, a favor dele, adoro ele, e tenho assistido o filme do Denzel Washington, que ele cita quase que toda a Bíblia, o Corão e tudo mais. Viu? Bem franco com o senhor. Viu?
Does hanging count as torture? Thank you for that.
Boa noite também. Boa noite, não. Bom dia. Bom dia. Minha dúvida é com relação aos precedentes ainda. O senhor falou da responsabilização de agentes do Estado que praticam a tortura. Agora, minha dúvida é com relação aos precedentes em relação a condenações baseadas em tortura. Se isso tem sido aceito pelos tribunais americanos, se há precedente nesse sentido, se não tem havido questionamento por parte da defesa com relação ao uso desses instrumentos. Então, minha dúvida é com relação a isso. Agradeço a resposta.
Yeah, yes, absolutely. We see that primarily in the military commission trials of people like Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and other detainees at Guantanamo Bay. As we also see it in some of the civilian trials, Zacharias Moussaoui, for instance, who we'll talk about him in a future class session. He was prosecuted after the 9/11 attacks in a regular civilian criminal court. In these cases, the defendants, even if they were not themselves tortured, they will say things like, the information that the government is using against me, they acquire that information through the CIA interrogation program, right? They know, they allege that I am an Al-Qaeda member because Khalid Sheikh Mohammed told them I'm an Al-Qaeda member. And the reason Khalid Sheikh Mohammed said that was because they waterboarded him. So the information that is being used against me is not properly introduced in court, so we file a motion to suppress the information. So you see that kind of move. Now, that's not really so. When it's presented in that context, the question is not, you know, did the defendant commit torture sufficient to meet the terms of the statute. The question presented is, should we suppress the evidence because it's unreliable, right? So you have some case law examining the CIA interrogations, but it's understood differently or it's interpreted differently than you would see it in a normal criminal prosecution. Yes, please.
Good morning. My question regards these techniques, a good cop, bad cop, the ban on threats. How much does it happen in practice? Is it difficult to get the permission from an official, or is just marketing thing so that the civil society can accept something and thus creating a good image to the government, but this taking place on an everyday basis?
Do you mean taking place by the military and the CIA, or do you mean taking place by police officers? Okay, CIA and Army. Okay, so the basic answer is the CIA doesn't do it at all because the CIA no longer has an interrogation program. And part of the reason the CIA no longer has an interrogation program is because they can't live under the legal limits that are in the Army Field Manual. You can't do interrogation. The CIA can't do interrogation if it has to live by these rules. Yeah, yeah.
Is that real or is something just marketing?
Is there a secret CIA interrogation program that we don't know about? I don't know. I guess we'll find out when the memos leak. When the next Edward Snowden documents come out, we'll have to wait for those to find out.
Well, now we are having a break, a coffee break. We have 15 minutes.
Aqui o questionamento, mas é importante que a gente respeite, de certa forma, o horário. Muito obrigado e vamos para o intervalo.